We will get started. Today's plan is to continue with matrices and matrix algorithms, specifically of a numerical flavor. So before we do that, let's quickly recap a little bit. By the way, the midterm syllabus will not include any kind of sophisticated numerical algorithms on matrices. As long as you know how to declare a matrix right into a cell using one or two indices and retrieve a value from a matrix cell using again one or two indices, that will be enough. Okay. So the specific algorithms I'm describing today, nothing like that is included in the midterm. So this is how you declare a native matrix with two dimensions. And we already said that logically you need the row index to be between 0 and rows, column to be between 0 and columns, 0 inclusive, columns exclusive. And if you violate that rule, you might be accessing weird memory locations without an idea of what value you're supposed to get. So internally, the C or C++ compiler makes no distinction between a 2D matrix, which is 3 by 5, and a 1D matrix, which has 15 elements. They both have 15 elements. In case of the 1D matrix or vector, the elements are numbered 0 through 14. So the only facility C and C++ will give you is, given the allocation statement where rows and columns are actually instantiated as numbers, it will use that to calculate the one-dimensional cell number corresponding to a two-dimensional cell number. So since I know the number of columns in the matrix, I can calculate the cell number of Rx Cx as Rx into columns plus Cx. And we saw that this corresponds to a row-wise unrolling of the elements of the matrix. So element 00 starts at byte 0 and is called cell 0. And right up to the first row, then the second row, then the third row, to the last element, which is cell number 14. But byte number 56 through 59. And this is for an int matrix where each cell takes exactly 4 bytes. So we saw a demo of it, and we also saw that you can create illegal indices which walk outside the legal area of cells that you have allocated. But as long as the C or C++ compiler can dumbly calculate a cell number, it will just compute that and access it. If it's outside 15 cells, even then you can access it, as we already saw in case of one-dimensional vectors. But if it's inside, then of course there's no further way of protecting yourself against getting nonsense values. So, and then we looked at some of the very basic operations on matrices. You can initialize a square matrix to identity by assigning the diagonals to 1 and off diagonals to zeros. That changes very, very slightly if you want to initialize an upper triangular matrix with 1s. In which case you just test that the row is less than or equal to column, and then you assign them to 1. That's the light gray area. And then if Rx is greater than Cx, then those are zeros, as represented by the dark gray area. So those are very simple things to do. Generally speaking, you'll read large matrices from data files, and you usually not enter them by hand. But today, because we'll see very small examples, I will set elements to specific values inside the code itself. How do you transpose a square matrix? The idea is to not double transpose, so don't go below the diagonal. Stay above the diagonal and interchange two elements across the diagonal at a time. Okay. So here is the first shot. The 3x3 array has elements 1 through 9 as listed. First you go to the cells colored yellow, 2 and 4, and you interchange those. Then you look at the cells 3 and 7, then you interchange those. And finally, you look at the cells 6 and 8, and you interchange those. So see that you needed to only look at above diagonal elements and swap them with their mirror images in the diagonal. Okay. So what's the mirror image? The mirror image of cell RxCx is the cell CxRx. That reflects it in the diagonal where Rx is equal to Cx. And there's no reason to try to swap the diagonal because nothing will change. So that's why we have strictly a plus 1 here. So there's no need to swap anything on the diagonal itself. So that's transpose. easy enough. And then matrix vector multiplication, all of you have done by hand, and by now the index arithmetic should be fairly clear. If A has rows, rows, and calls, columns, then the, and we're calculating y equal to ax, then the sizes, so this is rows, that is calls, this is A. So x will have to have calls, rows, and the answer you get is y, which again has rows, rows. Okay. So that's the sizes and proportions. And the code itself is extremely simple. The outer loop is on Rx. Once you lock a particular row, you are going to also write into Rx of y. Okay. This is y. And within that, we first set y of Rx equal to 0. And then we walk Cx simultaneously across the columns of A and the rows of X. So A Rx Cx times X Cx, those are multiplied and then accumulated onto Y Rx. Okay. So that's the copybook definition of matrix vector multiplication, and there is really no need to do it any smarter. This is fine, this is the best you can do. Now, of course, this is true for dense matrix vectors. In case the matrix or the vector becomes sparse, things will get more interesting. And we will see many, many occasions where we'll need very vast, very sparse matrices. For example, so here's one matrix that could be very interesting to us. Suppose people in, say, Facebook are numbered 0 through n minus 1. And this is also 0 through n minus 1. And if person I is friends with person J, then I'll set that cell to 1. Otherwise, I'll set cells where I and J are not friends to zeros. Then this is a very nice logical representation of the friendship graph. But because most people are not friends with most people, this matrix has a vast majority of zeros and very few ones. So you, of course, would not want to hold it in a dense format. But now it's complicated by the fact that there are two dimensions. And one of the ways to store it would be just to say I, J, and 0, 1. So we can have three ganged arrays, one of which gives the row index, the other gives the column index. And then there's a value array which gives either 0 or 1. That would be a standard sparse representation. And if you had that, then finding matrix vector multiplies would be much more interesting. So we'll talk about that perhaps after the midterm. But for now, for today at least, we are dealing with entirely dense arrays, matrices, and we'll probably continue that for another lecture. So matrix vector multiplication animation is just follows that chalked up diagram there. So I look at A00 and multiply it by X0. A01 and multiplied by x1, A02 multiplied by x2, and that gives me y0, and so on. Okay. Now, then I started talking about matrices as transformations, and some of you may already have known about this, but just to bring everyone up to the same point, if you look at, say, in the 2D plane, a 2x2 matrix, you can take a 2D, a two-element vector like x, which is x0 and x1, and multiply it by A to find Y. Now, it's a little confusing for us who are used to the x-axis being X and y-axis being Y. This is not the same thing. Okay? Each of X and Y has two dimensions. The dimensions or the axes are axis 0 and axis 1. Okay? So I apologize for the slightly confusing letters used. Okay? Y is not the y-axis. So I start with a point, x0, y0, which is plotted right here. Okay? So the horizontal coordinate of that is x0, and the vertical coordinate of that is x1. And then I multiply it by a 2x2 matrix, and that amounts to transforming this vector x from the origin to this point to a different new image vector y, which is y0 and y1. So in this case, y0 equal to twice x0 plus 1 x1, and y1 equal to x0 plus 3x1. So I do this mapping and I find the vector y joining the origin to the tip of, you know, y0, y1, and that's a transformation. Okay. Now, if you remember, we have already seen things like these when we talked about people migrating from city to city. Effectively, we are saying that y0 is the next population of Mumbai and y1 is the next population of Pune, and that's some linear multiple of their old populations. Right. So these things are all over the place. In particular, if you have, say, in electrical engineering, I could make up a linear circuit with resistors like this. Okay. And let's say every node here, so how many of you have heard about Kirchhoff's law? So charge cannot accumulate at a node, it has to go somewhere. So the total flow into a node of current has to equal the total exit of current from the node. So let's say the potential of any node I is V of I. The potential here is V of J, right? And then the current here is V of I minus V of J divided by Rij, right? So that's another kind of linear transformation, because I can now write linear recurrences across all the Vs and try to solve them. Okay. So this sort of things are all over engineering, and that's why eigensystems are so important. So we saw that if we choose the x0 and x1 to always lie on this locus, which is the unit circle around the origin, then the transform points y fall on an ellipse in general, right? And so we map this circle to an ellipse like this. So observe one thing, which is that, you know, the pre-image is on the circle, the post-images are on an ellipse, and the important thing is that there are these two directions which are not changed by the transformation A. Okay. That we already saw. That's the major axis, that's the minor axis. But one other thing to note quickly is that near the minor axis, the rays are diverging away from the minor axis. Near the major axis, they're sort of converging onto the major axis. That is a very critical difference. This is why it's so easy to find the first eigenvector and first eigenvalue, but you need more complicated procedures to find the lower order eigenvalues and eigenvectors. Okay. So we'll discuss that in more detail now. So this is fine, right? So circle goes to ellipse. The ellipse has, of course, two axes. So these two axes are stretched but not turned by the transformation A. Okay. It's okay. So let's say these two directions that are stretched but not turned are called U0 and U1. Those are the red arrows on the screen, right? Now observe that if U0 is not turned, then neither is minus U0. So throughout this discussion, whenever I'm saying find U0, your numerical procedure may well find minus U0. Okay, the opposite direction of the axis is directionally the same. The sign is different. The lengths of the semi-major and the semi-minor axis are called the eigenvalues, because the unit vector which finishes on the circle manages to get stretched into a longer vector here in general. It could also be shorter. Okay. The ellipse might be thin enough that it falls inside the circle at some points. Okay. Now, lambda zero is the length from here to there. And so that's the ratio by which a unit vector got stretched. Similarly, lambda 1 is the length from here, oops, to there. Okay. Now, by definition, lambda 0 is greater than lambda 1. Now, certain matrices, of course, have lambda 0 equal to lambda 1, in particular, the identity matrix. Okay. But in general, you'll have lambda 0 and lambda 1 different. And let's say lambda 0 is the larger one. Now, U0 and U1 are also perpendicular to each other by definition. The major and minor axis of an ellipse are perpendicular to each other. And they also have, let's say they have unit norm. Okay, so in fact, U0 is the vector going from here to there, and that is lambda 0 U0. U1 is the vector going from here to the circle, and lambda 1 U1 is the one that goes up to the ellipse. Okay. Now, the two red arrows of unit length going up to the circle, those are now like a new axis system. They are perpendicular to each other. They have unit norm. Now we can express any point in the earlier coordinate system as a point in the new coordinate system. Fine? So suppose I take any old vector here. So let's say I take a vector like so, okay, finishing here, where the cursor is now. That has a coordinate in the original system. But I can also take its projection onto the two red axes and calculate a new coordinate with regard to u0 and u1. So because the two red axes are at perpendicular to each other, I can express any point in the new coordinate system. Now, let's say that in general, I pick an initial vector x which has coordinates 1 and c for some arbitrary constant c. Okay. By changing c, I can implement pretty much any reduction, almost, with finite c. Okay. And it will eventually turn out that it doesn't matter where we start off x anyway. So you can feel free to choose any c you want, actually. Okay. So basically, we start off with some x which is proportional to u0 plus cu1. Okay. Because I can't draw easily on the LCD screen, and I shouldn't, here is the origin. Here is the circle. Here was the new coordinate system, u0, u1. Right? What I'm saying is that let's pick any vector, like so, whose projections on u0 and u1 are 1 and c, respectively. Okay. So by changing c, I can turn the vector x around as I wish. So there's no loss of generality. Okay. Now let's see what happens if I take this x and keep multiplying it by a. Okay. So power iteration finds the largest eigenvalue lambda and the corresponding eigenvector u, lambda 0, u0 actually, of the matrix A by initializing x arbitrarily, for example, u0 plus u1c. And then it repeats finding y equal to ax, that's a matrix vector multiply. And then it resets or overwrites x with y divided by norm of y. Okay. Now, let's say, for the sake of argument, that before starting out, I normalize x to unit norm. So x always remains unit norm. Okay. Like here, after picking this general deduction, this is x, I can always drop it back to the unit circle and take that up to that blue vector. So that's my first x. Okay. So in general, what I'm going to do is I'm going to start from some arbitrary vector x, which I'll call x0. And then I'm going to pull it out to the ellipse. I'm going to drop it back to the circle, pull it out to the ellipse again, and keep doing that as we saw last time, until I end up on the major axis of the ellipse. So why does this work? And we can see, we already saw a demo using Scilab, but I'll today show an implementation in C++. So let's call the sequence of values of x and y as x super 0, y super 0, x super 1, y super 1, and so on. Okay. So we use superscripts for this because the elements of x and y will use the subscripts, possibly. So the setup so far is clear, notation setup. I have an initial vector x, which can be expressed as 1 and c in the u0, u1 coordinate system, and I keep multiplying it by a. Okay. So this is what happens when we do that. So we'll go through line by line carefully. So remember I said I'll initially drop x0 down to the unit circle, which means even if I was given the original vector as u0 plus cu1, I have to normalize it to unit norm. Now u0 has unit norm, u1 has unit norm. Therefore, the norm of the numerator is square root of 1 plus c squared. Right, so I have to divide by that. And now x0 gets unit norm. Fine. Now at this point, let's find y1, which is ax0. So if you just multiply it through, it's easy to see that if I multiply u0 by a, that's just lambda 0 u0. If I multiply u1 by a, then that's just lambda 1 u1. What I've done is I've pulled the lambda 0 outside to leave u0 plus c lambda 1 over lambda 0 inside. Okay, and the denominator so far is the same. What's the norm of y1? The norm of y1, you can pull out the constant anytime out of the norm. inside it is 1 plus c squared lambda 1 over lambda 0 squared. Fine, because u0 and u1 have unit norms. Fine. So that's the norm of y1. Now for the next step, when I replace x0 by x super 1, I get y super 1 divided by norm of y super 1, which is u0 plus cu1 divided by this stuff divided by this. So various things cancel out. The 1 plus c squared cancels out. The lambda 0 cancels out. And I'm just left with u0 plus c lambda 1 over lambda 0 u1 divided by the square root, this big square root here. And now you see this kind of pattern, and you can repeat this iteratively a few times until you see the pattern, which is after k steps, where k is greater than or equal to 1, x super k is going to be u0 plus lambda 1 over lambda 0 to the power k u1, and therefore the norm has to be 1 plus c squared lambda 1 over lambda 0 to the power 2k. Okay? Everyone comfortable with this? Now, what happens when k goes to infinity? So remember that by definition, lambda 0 is the bigger guy. Lambda 1 is smaller than lambda 0. So lambda 1 over lambda 0 is a strict fraction. Therefore, as k grows without bound, the second part just vanishes. And we are left with u0. Okay. So in other words, if I start off with any vector, which is some linear composition of the first and second eigenvector, and I keep on multiplying by A and normalizing it, the coefficient of the second eigenvector will diminish to 0, and only the first eigenvector will survive. Okay. So that's the reason why power iteration works. Fine. Now, as you can see, this sort of algorithm will no longer suffice to find the second eigenvector. We'll have to do something special. And also, I noted that this is one occasion where the limitations of finite precision arithmetic will actually save you from wandering around the various axes of the ellipse. Because what will happen is that in the picture, it's already somewhat intuitive that near the minor axis, you see the blue rays as diverging away from the red line. Whereas near the major axis, they're kind of coinciding. So there's actually a stabilizing effect. If you're close to the major axis, you'll not move far away. Whereas even if you start off at the minor axis, and your finite machine precision will jiggle a bit here or a bit there, even if you initially line up x to be exactly along the second eigenvector, okay, after multiplying by a, as you have already seen, there'll be some inaccuracy. That inaccuracy will move you slightly away from the red ray, and then the blue rays will take care of it and move you away from the minor axis. Okay. Now, in general, for matrices with larger sizes, if I have a 5 by 5 matrix, then I'm going to have, instead of an ellipse, I'm going to have an ellipsoid, okay, something like an American football. Okay. And that will have so many axes, that will have 5 axes, it just turned in the space, but it has one major axis. And all the other axes are smaller than that. So all the lower order eigenvalues will die away in the same way. It's very easy to extend this argument to multiple more dimensions. Okay. So the only messy part is if there are two dominant eigenvalues with exactly the same value. Okay. But you can read up any linear algebra book about how to deal with that. So in this class, we are not going to tackle that. This is, after all, a programming class. So how do I implement this and when to stop. Okay. So we stop when xk minus 1 and xk are sufficiently close to each other. Okay. And one way to check that is to set up some sort of a threshold epsilon and say that the L2 norm of the difference between the last x and this x has to be less than epsilon. Then I'll quit. Okay. So for you to explore is how do you find u1, lambda 1, and in case of higher dimensional or higher sized 2D matrices, how do you find, say, u2, lambda 2, u3, lambda 3, how to do that? Okay. So we'll come back to that when we do more linear algebra after the midsems, but you can try to think about it. So let's write boost code for power iterations. The building blocks we will need are, of course, matrix and vector, and we have seen some of that already. It's very easy to declare a matrix and vector and fill them with values. We also need vector difference so that we can calculate xk minus 1 minus xk. We also need norm. So, and we also need matrix vector multiplication. Those are all already provided by the Boost uBLAS library. And the code will be extremely short. The code will in fact be almost as short as the conceptual pseudocode that we have outlined already. This is actually running Boost code. So infinite loop. I already have a and x initialized outside, filled with values. So now I say a vector of double y is product of a and x. Okay. Then I say vector of double nu x is y divided by norm 2y. Boost already defines a method called prod and a method called norm 2. Okay. But observe also that y slash norm 2y means something different from slash. Because usually standard slash is when you're dividing an integer by an integer or a short by a short, a float by a float, or a double by a double. Here, it seems like I'm dividing a vector by a double. Norm 2y returns a double. Okay. So Boost redefines slash so that if you apply it to matrices or vectors in the correct way, in some meaningful way, like dividing a vector by a constant number, it can do that silently. Inside it, rolls out into a lot of code. So how do you divide a vector by a constant? Well, you divide every element by that constant. I think by now everyone should be able to write that code. But it's already implemented for you. Okay. Now, then what I do is, I have a new x, I have an x, so I can subtract it. Observe that, again, this subtraction is not subtracting two doubles or subtracting two floats. Boost defines a new minus, which can deal with arrays or vectors of the same size on the two sides. And it does element-wise subtraction, similarly with element-wise addition. If the sizes are conformant, then sums and differences of matrices are well-defined, and Boost will do it for you. On top of that, I can now apply norm 2. And if that drops below epsilon, which you have somehow defined somewhere, then you break the loop. Otherwise, you set x to new x, and then you continue. Like many other occasions, there's no reason to store all the historical xi's or xk's. I just need to store the previous one and the next one just to compare if I'm close enough. Then I quit the loop. So extremely simple code calculates eigenvectors for you and eigenvalues. So let's see a demo of that. So the other mumbo jumbo in front is just to get a and x set up. There's nothing real going on. Okay. So I define my epsilon to be say 10 to the power minus 5. A is a matrix of doubles of size 2 by 2. And I initialize it to the same number used to produce those pictures. So 2, 1, 1, 3. Okay. Now I create this vector of doubles. And I don't really care where I initialize them. All you know is that for any reasonable initialization of x, there exists a value 1 and a value c, such that x can be expressed in terms of u0 and u1 for the sake of analysis only. As far as running the algorithm, you don't need to know what 1 and c are. That's just to prove that convergence will happen. Okay. So this is an example of a piece of code where convergence is non-trivial to prove. Convergence doesn't happen because you're running through indices and you run out of an index, or you reach the end of an array, or you're finished merging two arrays. Convergence happens because of certain mathematical properties of eigenvalues. You have to analyze that and convince yourself that you will exit the loop at some point for any positive epsilon. Okay. So now I start iterating. And here I actually record the iteration number just so I can print things out. Yes. It depends on how you interpret it. So when you take a product with a matrix, it will be interpreted as a column vector, so it can be multiplied by a matrix. Yeah, so I haven't tried left multiplying it. So you can try it out and see if it throws an error or not. So inside the loop, here it's the same as what was in the slide. The only additional baggage is to print things out. Otherwise, nothing has changed. So I produce y, which is a times x. I produce new x, which is y divided by norm of y. And I calculate the error. Error is norm 2 of new x minus x. And then I print out the iteration number. The current vector y itself, the value, let's see, maybe I should print out new x instead, because that's closer to a normalized eigenvector. And then I print out the eigenvalue estimate, the ratio of the old and the new length and the old length 1. And then I print out the error, which is how much have I changed from the previous estimate of x. Fine. So, and then, you know, if error is less than epsilon, then I break. Otherwise, I set x to new x, and then I continue the loop. Very, very simple code. So most of the complexity has been hidden inside the Boost libraries. And in fact, you know, after midsems, when we start declaring our own functions more extensively, then you'll see that this is the only way to code. You don't want to, you know, unfold your code in all detail in one place, because reading it becomes unmanageable. You want to write modules such as taking a norm, such as multiplying a matrix and a vector. You want to give it a name. And not only can you reuse it from multiple places without repeating the same code again and again, but you know, it makes it the code much easier to read. This is much easier to read than if I unrolled out all the loops and made it like 4 levels deep and so on. Error will never be equal to 0 technically. Oh, error is a double, so not error is not directly defined. Error is a double precision number. Error is not an integer, for example. You can only do not on integers in C and C++, and that's like a blight, so don't do it. Okay, so all I need to say is that the error is small. No, so this floating point number, double error, this will shrink towards 0. Okay. To actually get to the last, to squeeze out the last bit to 0, may take a long time for one thing. And it may even never happen. The reason is this, that you could have xk minus 1 and xk oscillate around the value required to give you exactly 0. Okay, and then xk plus 1 will be xk minus 1 again. So you'll do a little alternation just because of finite precision. You'll never reach that x star, which gives you exactly 0 error. So you definitely need this epsilon. Otherwise, you may oscillate at the end and never reach 0 and not exit the loop. Okay, so that's an important question. Because of finite precision, it may well happen that you cycle at the end. Okay. So it's better to have this epsilon error and quit on that. So this code is clear, right? So in fact, I'm done in 11 iterations only. I started off with this vector, which was 0.3, 0.9-ish. And the eigenvalue was found to be 3.16, and the error was 0.3, which was quite large. So in iteration 1, I updated my point on the circle to 0.44 and 0.89. You can verify that all these things lie on the unit cycle circle. And the eigenvalue was updated to 3.53, and the error was smaller. And you can see the error is decreasing quite drastically. Okay. And finally, around iteration 11, between 10 and 11, the vector hardly changes. It's 0.5, 0.8. That's the eigenvector. Okay. And the eigenvalue is 3.61. And the error has come down to about 9.6 in 10 to the power minus 6. Okay. So this convergence is quite fast. In fact, for those of you interested in numerical linear algebra, you can try to find theorems which talk about, as you go down iteration by iteration, at what rate will the number of leading zeros after the decimal point increase. There's actually a very reliable connection between the number of iterations and the number of zeros. I don't exactly remember what it is, but it's monotonically increasing. But it also depends on the ratio of lambda 1 to lambda 0. If lambda 1 and lambda 0 are very close together, you're going to have slow convergence. If lambda 1 is much smaller than lambda 0, you're going to have fast convergence. We saw it already from the formula. Okay. The other comment I needed to make is that being that vulnerable to the ratio of lambda 1 and lambda 0 is not always a nice thing. So for example, Google needs to compute the eigenvector of the web graph. Okay. By which I mean, so if you look at the matrix I drew here, so these two people are friends, other people are not friends, and so on. There's a similar graph that Google needs to mine. which is the web graph of links. What page links to what page? Okay. So it turns out that a very important signal into Google's ranking algorithm is the dominant eigenvector of that matrix. So Google needs to compute the dominant eigenvector of a matrix that is 20 billion by 20 billion. Okay. Whereas we are starting with 2 by 2. Now, once you start computing the eigenvector of a 20 billion by 20 billion matrix, which is very, very sparse, every row and column has typically only 30 to 40 non-zeros. Each page links to about 30 pages on an average. Okay. Then you realize that you can save every cycle you can afford to. And there are algorithms to further speed up the rate of convergence beyond the elementary algorithm that I have talked about. Okay, people have done whole PhD thesis. There are at least, I can point out at least 10 PhDs on how to speed up eigenvector convergence at that scale. Okay. So that's another very intriguing area of numerical analysis with enormous impact on current web companies and many other areas of data mining. So let's try a small tweak on the code. Okay, we'll remember the last couple of values in a buffer, and then we'll change the value a little bit and see what happens. So this is with the old initialization. Now let's initialize this to, let's pick some other x. So I'll pick -1, and I'll pick -1. So now the initial value is pointing in some other direction. Okay. Let's recompile and run the code. Yeah, excuse me. So now what happens if we run this? The vector now is both negatives, but the value is the same. Okay. So now I've converged slightly earlier, one iteration. Now if I compare this to what I had last time, this is what I have, exactly or almost exactly the negative of the old vector, but the ratio is the same. So this is exactly corresponding to snapping to the opposite direction of the dominant eigen axis. If I start closer to one side, I'll snap to that. If I start closer to the other side, I'll snap to that other end of the ellipse. Okay. So there is no distinction between finding u0 and -u0. The direction is the same. And the ratio is the semi-major axis length. That should also be the same. Okay. Any questions on finding eigenvectors and eigenvalues? Okay. Now, some of you might be thinking at this point that, well, I kind of rigged the elections. I picked a value of A, which gave, in particular, real eigenvalues. Not all matrices have real eigenvalues or real eigenvectors. It could be complex, right? So if you are expecting your matrix to have complex eigenvalues or complex eigenvectors, then you have to start it off with complex numbers. So we'll discuss that in after midterms. Okay. We haven't even talked about complex numbers and what to do with them. So we'll do a little bit of that once we come back after the exam. Now, some of you might know how the eigenvalues look like when plotted on the complex plane. Okay. So basically, complex numbers will come in conjugate pairs. Some of the eigenvalues would be on the real line. Those can come in singles. Any complex eigenvalue will have to come in a pair, a conjugate pair. Okay. So we'll talk more about this later on. So any questions about eigenvalues and eigenvectors? Of course, if you increase the size of the matrix, you'll get so many eigenvalues and so many eigenvectors. The algorithm will still give you the top one, lambda 0 and u 0.
Yes?
No, it's your application dependent. You have to decide what accuracy you need.
I can't just put equation and expect that the computer will decide.
No, you have to define what you mean by epsilon. Otherwise, it will be an undeclared variable. And it entirely depends on what precision your application needs. Okay, so to continue with more matrix operations, the next is matrix-matrix multiplication. And this looks busy and clumsy, but if you know how to multiply a matrix and a vector, you already know how to multiply two matrices. It's just that the second vector became a stack of vectors, that's all. So there are three matrices here. Let me draw the ratios again. The point is I can't hold both of them together on screen, so the board is better. So the first matrix is of size L by M. So it's generally a bad idea to name variables single letters in the code because it's harder to search for it. You search for that single letter, you find it all over the place. You don't find the variable. Okay. So generally speaking, it's a good idea to have multi-letter variables. So I call it L size and M size. But on board, I'll show it as just one symbol. So it's L rows by M columns. Okay. And to multiply with it, B has to have M rows and say N columns. And that results in a matrix C, which of course has size L by N. Okay. So that's the geometry. And now the code proceeds by having three nested loops. You should think of the two outer loops as targeting C. That's why they're named starting with C. So you basically say, I want to fill up C odd X and C C X. So C odd X is the row index of C. C C X is the column index inside C. Okay. Now how do I fill it up? I initialize C matrix to 0. Okay. And then I have this combined ABX cursor. I start off at CRX here. I start off at CCX here. That looks more like here. And then ABX will go that way. And ABX will come down this way. And you run through those two vectors lockstep, multiply the two values, accumulate onto CMAT. So three loops, it's quite like matrix vector multiplication, but X has many columns, so it's a triple nested loop. And the time required is L size times M size times N size. Okay, why is that? The outermost loop goes for CRX equals, and the number of iterations of the outer loop is clearly L size. Then the next loop says CCX equals, and clearly the number of iterations of that is N. So whatever is here is being executed LN times. And then the stuff here is another for loop which takes ABX from 1 to M, okay, or 0 through M minus 1. So this stuff takes M time. Therefore, the overall time required is LNM. Any questions about matrix multiplication? It's really simple. And you don't need to do it anyway because Boost already does it for you. Okay, so now that we can multiply matrices and vectors together and matrices and matrices together, the next extremely important application we'll look at is least squares fit. Okay. A lot of you will, you know, hopefully do experiments and then collect data from them. For example, we might be, you know, in a high school electricity lab, you might be putting a battery across a resistor and then, you know, changing the battery voltage by putting more and more cells in series and then measuring the current through the resistor. And you're not given the value of the resistor, you have to find the value of the resistor. Right? That's a typical lab. And there are more complex things that people do. So suppose you are given a reading of battery voltage and current. And you do a scatter plot of those. If your experiment conditions were absolutely ideal and your meters were perfect, then you'd get an exact straight line through the origin because V equal to IR. In practice, this will not happen. Okay. We have already seen occasions to do measurements in this course earlier. For example, I'm trying to do, say, selection sort, and I'd like to find out how much time my selection sort would take as a function of N, the number of elements in the array. So one way would be to just time it using the system time command and then plot N versus the time, or time against N. And because selection sort is expected to be a quadratic time algorithm, you expect that your running time would be something like t equals some constant times n squared. Okay. But it will never be exactly n squared. There will be some initial setup time for the code. So it will be more like, you know, a0 plus a1 n plus a2 n squared. That's your estimate of the running time. Right. So suppose I collect numbers like this. I have n and I have t. And my estimated model is that t equal to a0 plus a1 n plus a2 n squared. But I don't know what a0, a1, and a2 are. Why would it be interesting to estimate a0, a1, and a2? Well, a0 would give you some estimate of the time that your Linux kernel and bash shell take to set up your process and tear it down. That's independent of the size of n. Okay? Whereas a1 might give you a good estimate of how much time your runtime library takes to allocate an array of size n. That's expected to be about linear in n, say. Initialize it to the initial values, reading the values from files, that should be proportional to n. And then the actual sorting time, you expect to be proportional to n squared. But the three constants of proportionality might differ. Reading from files is very slow, so you expect a1 to be pretty large. Setting up a process, tearing down a process at the end, printing things to the terminal, that's also slow. So a0 might be quite large as well. But sorting inside RAM is very fast. We know that access to random access memory is very fast. So you expect A2 to be quite small. Beyond this, you have no initial idea. So instead of guessing, you just use a whole bunch of values of n. You collect the corresponding values of t. And then you'd like to do a fit. So how do you fit this? So here is the process. So you collect a matrix called x. Okay. Now, let me rename the variables a bit because this might get a little confusing. So let's say this is n, and that is t. I might reuse some of these later on. So this is capital N. And let's say I do a sum total of n experiments, small n experiments. So I run the code 100 times, small n is equal to 100. Whereas capital N might go into millions, you want to sort bigger and bigger arrays. Okay. So forget about capital N now. I only have these three things, right? So what I do is I line up those N experiments as rows of a matrix. Okay. In each row of the matrix, I put three numbers. Okay. Remember, each row corresponds to one experiment. The experiment that started with n elements and took time t. Right. So my matrix is going to have three columns, where in the first column I'll put one, constant one for all rows. In the second column I'm going to put n. In the third column I'm going to put n squared. The three factors which I believe govern the running time t. Okay. Now, I'm going to say that I'm multiplying it by this three-element array, which is A, A0, A1, A2. So clearly, for the ith experiment, the time should be A0 plus A1n plus A2n squared. Right. And meanwhile, I've used a stopwatch to also measure the time taken by the ith experiment. So that's Ti. So now the rest is clear. I would like to find A0, A1, A2 such that this matrix X times A is roughly equal to the T vector. Right? So that's written down in a slightly different notation in the screen. So my observations are x0 through xn minus 1, these rows. Okay. The model I'm trying to fit is w, which in this case corresponds to the three coefficients, a0, a1, and a2. And what I'm trying to fit is this observation called y. That's my running time. in case of running the code. Okay. So if I want this to be roughly equal, what do I mean? Well, we have done some of this in the past. If you want two vectors to be roughly equal, then you want the norm of their difference to be very small. So suppose I say, find a W which minimizes the L2 norm of the difference between two vectors. One is XW, which is the modeled part. So if you multiply these, you get what is the predicted running time of your code. And this is the actually observed running time of your code. Okay. So you say, I want to find a W which minimizes the discrepancy between the predicted running time and the observed running time. Now, turns out that the first line is equal to the second. The second line is just a way to write a inner product. Okay, so let me write down the x w equal to this skinny thing, right? And then I'm subtracting y. So that has also, that's the discrepancy of running times. I'm taking the transpose of that. So I'm taking that guy and I'm writing this times itself. XW minus Y transpose, XW minus Y. Okay. What's the product of a vector and its transpose? Well, it's X1 squared plus X2 squared. So that's the L2 norm squared. Okay. If I have a vector which looks like, say, P1 through Pn, this is also P1 through Pn. The inner product of a vector with itself is sum over I, Pi squared. So that's equal to L2 norm squared. Okay. So everyone okay with the last line in this slide? So that's what we want to minimize with regard to W. Okay. Now, so let's write this out. And at this point, you may or may not be totally comfortable with the notation. There's nothing sublime or profound going on beneath. It's just notation might be a little unfamiliar. But I'll go through it very slowly so that you are comfortable with it. So FW is what we are seeking to minimize with regard to W. Okay. So FW, as we have already written, is XW minus Y transpose XW minus Y. Okay. Now, the very elementary rule of transposition is that if I have, say, vector C, and I have A plus B transpose, that's equal to CA transpose plus CB transpose. So the very first line is pretty simple. You just expand out terms term-wise. And what is AB whole transpose? It's B transpose A transpose. Okay? So you should be comfortable with that. So we get W transpose XW in the second line. Minus, now if you look at the two terms, they look different, but they come to the same value eventually. Why is that? So the second term needs a little bit of study. The first way in which the second term happens is Y transpose XW. Right? The second way in which the second term happens is W transpose X transpose Y. Okay. They are the same. Why is that? Y transpose looks like this long skinny row. Okay. X looked like this, and W was like that. Okay. So this is Y transpose X W, whereas the second one is W transpose X transpose Y. You can verify that they will have exactly the same value. The value in particular will be one number. It's just a scalar. Why? Because on multiplying this by that, I'm going to get another skinny matrix, right? The product of those two is going to be one skinny matrix, column vector, and then that dot product will give me a scalar value. Okay. Similarly here, after multiplying this fat matrix with this skinny vector, I'm going to get just one short column vector. And after multiplying those two, I'll get a scalar. Okay. So what I'm writing as F is entirely a scalar. Although there are matrices involved inside, matrices and vectors, the final value is a scalar. Why? Because, okay, so what's W transpose X transpose XW? We didn't tackle that one before. So in shape, that looks like W transpose X transpose X and W, sorry. Okay. So this is W transpose, this is X transpose, this is X, that is W. Okay. So let me collect terms together. When you multiply those, what do you get? This combines with every column, thus giving you one line like this. Okay. That line combines with the next matrix, giving me just that. And then that combines with the last thing to give me a scalar value. Okay. So the second line has, the value of the second line is just one number. It's not a matrix or a vector. It's just one number. Right? And finally, there's minus plus y transpose y. But it doesn't matter because I'm trying to minimize fw with regard to w. And that last term doesn't even have a w in it. So it's immaterial. So how many people are okay until line 2 now? Line 2 is okay? So I'm trying to find a minimum of FW. Therefore, I have to take something like GW, which is F prime of W, and then set that to be equal to 0. That's how you do minimize a function, right? So again, there's some compact notation that you may or may not be familiar with. So when I take a form like W transpose XW and I differentiate it with regard to W, what does it even mean? Okay. So for those of you who are only familiar with scalar-based calculus, it's sort of like saying my FW, if W were a scalar, that is written here in the form of, say, W times something times W, which in scalar land would land up being called, say, AW squared. The second one is like a minus or whatever, plus BW, and then plus some constant. This is what I was trying to minimize with respect to W, and in matrix land, it turned into that strange expression. But there's no difference, really. So when I differentiate AW squared with regard to W, what do I get? I get 2AW, right? If W were a scalar. When W is a vector, and I have got this form, say W some matrix, W transpose some matrix W, and then W transpose some vector B, okay? Then what should my derivative be? Now derivative with regard to every element in W. So when F reaches a minimum, then DF over every DWJ should be equal to 0. Now, so all I need to do is to say that if I write df over dw without any subscript, what I mean is this whole vector. Okay? So df over dw1 or 0 right through df over dw, say m, if I had length m vectors. Fine? So that's what I mean by the gradient. And now it's not difficult to see that suppose F of W equal to say W transpose B, where B is some fixed vector. Okay. So that means this is equal to W1, W0, B0 plus, etc., plus WM minus 1, BM minus 1. Okay. Then what's the derivative of F with regard to the first coefficient? It's just B0. What's the derivative with regard to the second? It's just B1. Okay. So in other words, in this case, df over dw is nothing but b, the vector b itself. Okay. So as long as you line up your objective to look like w transpose b and you differentiate it, all you get is that, which is just as you differentiate in scalars. You just, if you know y equal to mx, then the derivative is m. Fine? So exactly in the same way, if you look at the quadratic term, you can easily do it in parts. You can do this part and that part. Okay, it has two parts. And if you add up the parts, you will see that it will be exactly equal to twice X transpose XW. So beyond this, you can manipulate the indices at home and convince yourself. But you take the leap of faith that in scalar algebra, you take a derivative of quadratic term, you get 2ax. Here you get 2x transpose xw. Okay. So that's f prime. And if I set that to be equal to 0, the right hand side to be equal to 0, then I get x transpose xw equal to x transpose y. Now if I solve this for w, how am I going to solve it for w? I have to take off the x transpose x, and in matrix land you can only do that by inverting. So w star, the solution which minimizes my fw, is going to be x transpose x inverse x transpose y. So this in one shot gives you a solution to the best model. Given x and given y, the best w or w star is given by that last expression. Fine? How many people are already aware of that last expression before they came to class today? Okay. The problem is that at least as far as CS101 is concerned, we don't know how to invert matrices yet. We'll learn soon, but we don't know how to invert. So could there be a way to find the best W without inverting a matrix? So observe that if I write a standard scalar expression, so this is a scalar, as ax squared plus bx plus c, where, and I'm trying to minimize it with regard to w. The minimum of a quadratic function like this is well defined only if a is greater than equal to greater than 0, right? So in which case the surface looks like a bowl, a parabola. There is a counterpart in matrix land. M has to be what's called positive definite. Okay. So we'll talk about that if you want later on also. Now, assume that M is already positive definite. If it's positive definite, then it's invertible. Okay. Now, if this is the form of F, what is the form of G? G is just linear, right? You differentiate a quadratic expression, you get a linear expression. So trying to find the minimum of F is equivalent to trying to find the minimum of G. A zero of G. Okay. How do you find the zero of a function? You can use Newton-Raphson method, okay? Or you can sort of use gradient descent, which means that, let me define, you know, FW as there. I define GW as F prime W. Okay. And now let's say I initialize with some arbitrary W0. This is again iterative. I want to do gradient descent. I want to minimize. Okay. So now I repeat. W at the next time step is equal to W at the previous time step minus something called a step size times G prime of W at the previous time step. Okay. So you want to reduce the function, you want to walk against the gradient. The gradient tells you the direction of increase, you want to decrease the function. So fix an arbitrary step size. This is very similar to that epsilon we saw before. It depends on what you can get away with. Okay. There's a lot of theory about setting step sizes that I can't even go into. There's huge theory on step size selection. Start with some W0, some arbitrary guess. Repeat for time equal to 1, 2, etc. Set WT to be WT minus 1 minus the gradient at the previous time step. Okay. Once again, until WT and WT minus 1 become very close. Suppose I am here, okay? So this is my WT minus 1. Okay, in standard gradient method, what happens is you find that the gradient here is positive. I'd like to reduce the function, therefore I have to go left. If instead I was here, then the gradient would be negative, and so I have to go in a positive direction. Right? So what happens in 1D here is very obvious. You find the local gradient, and you walk against the gradient to minimize the function. Exact same thing happens in matrix land. You find the gradient, the multidimensional gradient vector, and you take a step in the negative direction of that vector. Okay? So once I'm armed with more C++ graphics capability after midterms, I'm going to show you contours of equal function values and how the W is roaming around in that space. Okay? So we can't finish that today, but I'll give you some nice animation after the midterms. But broadly, the intuition just extends directly from one-dimensional optimization to multidimensional optimization. In one dimension, to the right of the minimum, the gradient is positive. Therefore, if I'm stuck in the right, I should go left. To the left of the minimum, gradient is negative, and so I should go with it to reduce the function value. This holds element-wise. If I find a gradient vector, I can always take the negative of the gradient vector and take a small step on it, so that I go towards the smaller function value. How many are comfortable with this way of minimizing it numerically? Okay. So in this specific problem, this is actually a guarantee to converge pretty much for any eta. It doesn't matter how carefully you pick eta. There are other problems where f is complicated enough that you need a lot of care with eta, but not in this problem. This problem is one simple parabola in multiple dimensions. Okay. So the surface is very simple and reliable. So how do we write boost code for it? So by now, you know, boost code looks really, really simple. Okay. So let's see. I will set up the following C++ code. So I will give you 3 points to fit a straight line through. Okay. So, and it's in 2D. So n, small n there is 3. Okay. And this is in 2D means that your observation is only one thing, but we'll pair it with a 1 as before. Okay. So I'm going to fit y equal to mx plus c. Okay. To fit the c, I need to pad every observation x with a 1. So I'm going to fit y equal to mx plus c. And what I'm given is x and y, a chart of those. Okay. I take my x and I pad a 1, and this bigger matrix becomes my capital X. Okay. And my W corresponds to a W0, which is my C. And the second one is M. Okay, so what I'm actually fitting is C and M in that order. So if I take, say, 1x1 times CM, I get C plus MX1. Next one will be C plus MX2. And I also have the Ys. So otherwise, the problem is all set up. Now I'm going to try an initial bug checking or test code where I'm going to give you X and Y values, which are extremely simple. I'm going to do 1, 1, 2, 2, and 3, 3. There is no least square required there. A single line fits to all of them. No problem. And then we'll jiggle the point around a little bit and see what happens. This is my starting point. So that's how the code looks like. So actually, the code here is a little flipped in that the x0, 0, the first column is actually the given values, 1, 2, 3. The second column is the pad of 1s. And y's are 1, 2, 3s. So clearly, the relationship should be y equal to x plus 0. So m is equal to 1. C equal to 0 is the correct relationship. Okay. Now I initialize my W vector with two things. And initially, they're all zeros. It doesn't matter. This ball has one global minimum. So no matter where you release a ball, it will always roll down to the bottom. Okay. It doesn't matter where you start. Okay. Now I have a step size which is arbitrary, 0.01. I'll take a step which is 1/100th of the gradient in every dimension. And now I have an infinite loop. It's pretty simple what I do. I have x, I can take the transpose of it. I call it x trans because I'll be using it, reusing it a little few times. If you are reusing a simple small scalar expression like square root of x, then calling it a few times may not be very expensive. If you're reusing X transpose in a bunch of places, you had better calculate it only once, otherwise you're going to waste space and time. So there, the C++ compiler is not smart enough to realize that your X will not be changed and it can be reused and so on. Okay. So I create X transpose once. I create X times W once, which is the product of X and W. Okay. Now, G of W was F prime, and I had an expression for it, which is X transpose XW minus X transpose Y. Okay, if you consult your notes, that's the expression for G of W. Okay. Two doesn't matter, right? So it's X transpose XW minus X transpose Y. And in Boost, it's this close, right? It's very easy to code. X transpose XW minus X transpose Y. And then the next W is W minus eta times gradient. And then, you know, currently I'm not quitting. Okay, I'm going to show you what happens if I run forever. I print out the current W and the next W. W goes to next W, and then I'll just finish up. So very simple loop. Let me run this. So I started off from 0, 0. After a little walk along the gradient, it became 0.14.06. 0.14.06 became 0.256.10, okay, and so on. Around here, it's 0.78 and 0.32. Keep going, keep going. Okay, 0.92.16, 0.95.10. 0.97.05, 0.98.02, 0.999000. Okay. So you see that I'm gradually converging to y equal to 1x plus 0. Okay. So now it's figured out that the gradient is 1 and the offset is 0. Fine. So let's tweak the values and just get some non-trivial gradients and offset. So suppose my offset was, say, 1. So let's put 2, let's put 3, let's put 4. And just for some fun, let's say 0.2, 2.9, 2.1. Okay. So I'll get somewhat different values. The best fit is not going to be y equal to x plus 1, but let's see what we get. So in the end, we should get something close to 1, 1. That's how I generated the points. So I start off with some arbitrary stuff, 1 and 0.4, 1.16.544. Keep going. Okay. So 1.05, 0.966. Kind of converged. So in fact, the true value may not be 1, 1 because of the given point, the least square fit will be a little different from 1, 1. So that's how you do least square fits. And I've only done it with 3 points, but of course you can use 3 million points if you want. Okay. So I can post instructions about generating random numbers on Moodle. You should try generating synthetic data where you take a straight line and then use random numbers to distort the points a little bit and get synthetic 2 million points and submit it to see if your Boost program can deal with it. Okay. So try that offline before the next lab after the midterms.